Jesus. on the line, online, on the line, at home or wherever you are. We want to welcome you here at this time. Church, can I just say, I love our Father. I love our Lord. Do you guys love Him? Amen. Man, He is so worthy of our worship. He is so good. He is so worthy of your time, of your thought, of your commitment, of your sacrifice. So church, I ask that we unite our hearts right now in this moment to commit ourselves to that love. Commit ourselves in response to that love to worship Him, to honor Him, because He is worthy. Amen? Amen. So Lord, we honor You today, God. We worship You today, God. We love You, God. We love You, God. Let's sing this. Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run. Sing it out, church. Beautiful. Let the King. Yeah, He's good. You are. You believe that, church? You are good. Oh, you are good. Oh, let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sail, the anchor in the waves. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, He is my song. Let's sing that again. Let the King of my heart be the wind. Lift up your voices, church. Be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, He is my song, 'cause You are good, You're good. Never gonna let me down. Amen. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
Yeah.
Gonna let.
that, church. Come on.
You're never gonna let
me. Yeah. Clap offer to our Father. He's so good. Amen. Lord, we honor you and we love you, God. We worship you, God. Yes, Lord. All of our songs, all of our hearts, we give to you today, Lord. Take it all, Lord. Take it all, Father. Of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, amen. We live for you, Jesus, the name above every other. You believe that? Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy,
holy, there is no one.
Name above
every other name.
Cry now.
Jesus, the only one that could ever see.
Yes.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Oh. God, you are so worthy, God, and I will build my life,
and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you.
Yeah. With that confession, oh, you are worthy. Oh, you are worthy, oh God. Oh, you are worthy, Lord. Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah, oh, oh, Lord, more than we know, more than we know. Deserve it all, you deserve it all our hearts, all our minds, all our lives, we give it to you, God, we give it to you, God. Oh, you are worthy of it all, God. Jesus, Jesus, oh, we love you, God. We love you, God. We love you, God, for who you are. We love you, God. You are worthy, God. You are worthy, God. We worship you, God. We love you, God. We give this time to you. We give our hearts to you. We give this worship to you. This place is yours. Our hearts are yours. Our lives are yours. These songs are yours. These tears are yours. Lord, take it all. Take it all, Father. That's an offering, God. We give it to you. Because you are worthy, God. You are worthy, God. We honor you, God. We honor you, God. We honor you, God. We worship you, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, God. Church, as we stand here in his presence, let's be reminded that we are just joining in on already the eternal forever song that's been going on and is going on and will forever go on. The eternal confession and proclamation of his worthy, his worthiness, his holiness, his greatness, his beauty. Even the rocks cry out. Even the mountains cry out. Whether you join or not, even the rocks cry out. So I encourage you, church, as we stand in his presence, to unite your hearts, unite your thoughts, commit right now to confessing that truth that he is holy and he is worthy. And that he deserves all praise. He deserves every single breath in our lungs. So commit this moment, this time to him again, church. And in faith, we can be expectant because I believe He wants to give us something new today. He wants to give us something new today. Because He is good. Because He is good.
All my life you have
just sing this. I know it's so old, and might bring back good or bad memories for some people, but let's just sing this song together.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
Yeah.
Little ones to hear below, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Cry it out.
Yes, oh, yes, he loves us. Yes. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so.
What else do we have to say, Father? It's because you said so, Lord. You love us. So with all our hearts, we offer this time to you in worship and praise. We honor you, God, and just again, we want to say we love you. And in Jesus' most mighty name we pray, amen. Can we give up a clap offering to our Father? Amen, amen. Jesus. Church, let's all stay standing for the confession of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Church, you may be seated.
All right, good morning, Jubilee. It's great to see everybody out here. I'm here to go ahead and share our church announcement, so let's go ahead and pay attention. But before I do, I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome anyone who's new here to Jubilee. First time here, never been here before. By the way, we have an orientation for you right after the service where we can get to know you and you us a little bit more. So if you're interested, please stick around and come to the front of the sanctuary where the newcomer's orientation will be. But for now, again, if this is your first time to Jubilee and never been here before, we'd love to welcome you and honor you and those wonderful things. So I'm going to ask you in this moment to not be shy, but raise your hand high. Otherwise, we can't see you. And show us that you are newcomers here at Jubilee. Is there anyone here who's here for the first time? Welcome, I see you, yay! Welcome, welcome. Welcome to Jubilee. And again, you guys are welcome to go ahead and join this newcomer orientation. All right, concerning our announcements now, we have our Bible study going on, our weekly Bible study on Wednesday nights with Pastor Tony Chung. It's actually the final Wednesday Bible study concerning the book of Judges. It's not too late to join because each study in its own has, I guarantee, the word of the Lord for you. So go ahead and come on out this Wednesday, if at all possible, 8 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. Because of the summer schedules for everybody, we'll be taking a break during the summer for Bible study. This is the last Bible study for some time. So all the more, let's make the effort to come on out. excuse me. We have a bunch of various ministry needs. Remember, we as a church, we're called to serve and not be served. And we have all these wonderful opportunities to step more and more into our Christian identities, to be more Christ-like, to really live to serve and not be served. Every time we serve, there's going to be a cost. Service is not a matter of convenience. It's a matter of sacrifice. So yes, more time, more effort. But again, this is our joy in the Lord. So there are all these opportunities to serve. So let's go ahead and get out of the habit of COVID non-momentum and move into COVID movement momentum and get serving, okay? Good. We have an all-members meeting next Sunday, May 22nd, for all those who are members of Jubilee. And during this time, we'll go ahead and share the information that we do with our members concerning the various updates concerning our church. So if you are a member of Jubilee, please plan to stick around right after service. We have this all-members meeting right after service. We have our children's ministry extended for those who are members with children, so we as adults can stick around and attend this meeting. And the meeting is going to be just about 30 minutes, so you don't have to worry that it's going to go on and no lunch and all that kind of stuff. This is not a fasting time. You will have time for lunch, so please plan on being there. Pentecost Sunday is right around the corner. We here at Jubilee recognize the three major events or three major holidays, Christian holidays or events in the calendar, which is obviously the coming of Christ, Christmas, the death and resurrection of our Lord, Easter, and then the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, God within us. This is Pentecost. Pentecost Sunday is coming right around the corner. It's the first month of June, first Sunday of June. And on Pentecost Sunday, we conduct baptism ceremonies. So if you're interested in baptism, you need to take the baptism class, which will happen on May 29th, two Sundays from now. That will be with me right after the service. So whether you are curious about what baptism is, you're ready to be baptized, you're not sure if you should be baptized, and all those kind of things, you need to take this class. This class does not mean that you have to be baptized. This is just informative only. However, if you are to be baptized, you do need to have taken this class. So please mark this on your calendar. You know, all our ministries really serve, but one of the ministries that I would definitely, it's not favoritism, but just really recognize the kind of effort that they put in is our children's ministry. You know, our children's ministry, they do an amazing job. We're not here to just babysit our children. They are teaching the word of the Lord up there. And to really honor them and appreciate them, because most of the team, they're volunteers. They're serving. So we are planning a children's ministry appreciation fundraiser. The goal amount is 1 million won. It's on our app. It's on Jubilink, so we can give towards it even right now. We're going to close this fundraising project on June 5th. So go ahead and let's go start giving and show our appreciation for all that our children's ministry does. And if I can put the onus particularly on this service, because we are the ones in this service who most enjoy that service, if you want to say it that way, all the more. Let's get on Jubilink ASAP right now and give and fill up this need, okay, this goal. Things are back in motion concerning more service, more outreach. Our summer Jokbang outreach. This is a domestic summer missions. The Jokbang is basically the slum areas of the city. And we're going to go to one in particular to help clean it up and hopefully help improve the quality of life for these people, these families who are in dire straits. But if you'd like to go, we have 10 spots only. It's only for 10 people. It's only a short time, June 9, 10, and 11, and we're not sleeping at a location or anything like that. Everybody goes home for the night to sleep in your own bed to reconvene the next day because it is a local outreach. It's Thursday to Saturday. So please go ahead and get signed up for that. However, so if you're interested, we have a translation booth. I don't know if you know, but we have a separate room for a translation booth to my right, to your left, in that corner of the sanctuary. You can meet with Pastor Yirang to get more information about this summer outreach opportunity. However, if you are also planning to go or thinking about going, you have to take our basic missions training class. Basic missions training to get an idea of what we're doing, to put our work in the context of the greater kingdom outreach that's been going on throughout the history of the world, right? So those dates are May 21 and May 28. You only need to go to one day. They're repeated on 2 days for convenience for us so that there'll be more opportunities to make sure that we can attend. So please keep this in mind. Let's see. It's from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., I believe. on Saturday, May 21st, or Saturday, May 28th. Okay, when you sign up for basic missions training, though, this doesn't make you already signed up for the trip. This is also, even if you're just interested, you can sign up. And if you want to just take the class, because it's a good class, it's run by Footstool Missions Center. So please keep this in mind, okay? Good, good, good. All right, we're almost there. I would say last but not least, we have this announcement concerning our missions fundraiser. And this is a big one. This is going to be on May 29th after our 2 p.m. service. The theme is a carnival theme. Come one, come all right? Now, please keep in mind a few things. That this is for all ages. Like in the fall, we have a fall festival, and it's usually geared towards the children, but this is for all people. So we'll have games like a carnival for even grown-ups. Throwing a football through a little hole is not just for little kids. I know that I love that game. I'll waste all my money on that game, you know, that kind of thing. And those games will be available. There's going to be raffles. So anyhow, it's for all ages. Please keep that in mind. But another thing is that, please remember that this is post-COVID. We're just getting out of it. And we are very much like breaking out of our old habits of COVID life. And one of the big things that we need to do together is to get together more often, to not give up meeting together. And this is an amazing opportunity to come together as a community for a good cause, to support the things that we want to do over the summer and some other projects that we'll be announcing. So we need participants, both coming, especially us here at the first service, because you actually have to make plans to come back after we have service, to come back and attend this thing. A lot of times, we don't come back. We only leave this fundraiser to the second service people because they just get to stay. But no, I really want to emphasize the reality that we need to come back to join and participate in this, all right? Because it's such a good cause and because we need to create the momentum of community building again. We need help too as well. Volunteers. We're looking for about 10 to 15 people as the setup and cleanup crew. Setup means coming in on Saturday to help set up. Lunch will be provided. Cleanup means coming up, sticking around after the event to clean up. Dinner will be provided. And though that may not be a commensurate in terms of the effort and time, but again, excuse me, service is not about convenience. Service is about cost. It's about sacrifice. So let's get our hearts and bodies moving to volunteer, because we need 10 to 15 people to help set up and clean up. We also need volunteering through giving of services, because this is a missions auction. We will be having We will also be having an auction, both silent and live. So another way you can participate in this is by donating to have silent auction items and live auction items. If we don't have auction items, we won't have an auction. And it would make this fundraiser not funded. You know what I mean? So we need your help to go ahead and provide these things. And I'm going to take this time right now to go through some of these items to inspire some ideas, because we're serious about trying to do this the best that we can. So services, right? This is not limited to this list, but check this out. You can provide services. A haircut or coloring. That means if you're a professional, not a hobbyist, okay? Yeah, we don't want to experiment. Housekeeping, coming in to help clean up. Meal services. A cooked meal for a group. Opening up your home and hosting. Cooking classes. Art class. Photography session. If you're into sports or fitness, how about sponsoring a membership to a gym for a time? A gift certificate for yoga, Zumba classes, a store gift card, sports equipment, tickets to a game. You know, there's a lot of wonderful games out there, professional sports in Korea, right? Gift basket items, date night for parents, a movie night, game night, skincare, golf supplies, a bunch of snacks, coffee-themed baskets for all you coffee lovers out there, a spa day packet, Jewelry or watch? Why not? Okay. Jewelries and watches. Why not? A travel and adventure. Weekend at an Airbnb. You can go ahead and sponsor this. A guided tour of the city. A park, a hike. Snowboarding lessons. You can wait until the winter, obviously, to redeem this coupon, right? Food or pop culture. Music basket. Gift certificates to restaurants. Personalized food tour. TV entertainment systems, musical instruments. There's all these things that we can go ahead and give as services or items. And of course, and raffle items too, you can just donate. This is, we're not looking at used products. Like, yeah, what can I find around the house? We're talking about quality things, new things that we can pay and give towards this event so there can be an auction so that even more funds can come in to support outreach. So, everybody understand? Let's get serious about this. Let's move together as a community. Let's give together as a community. And especially because this is going towards people with lots of needs. This is for an amazing opportunity and an amazing mission. So let's keep that in mind. And I guess that segues beautifully into actually what our last announcement is. Our electronic giving. We have a regular giving as well. You can give electronically. All the information is up there, as you see. Thank you for your time and your attention. And without further ado, we'll go ahead and move into a time of scripture reading and prayer. All right?
Good morning, church. Today's scripture reading comes from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Let us pray. Wonderful Father, our good shepherd and advocate, we acknowledge your presence with us gathered here today. You have made a way, and you daily keep on making ways for us to know you more and be drawn closer to you. Oh, how you love us. Formless, chaotic, empty, hollow, unstable, and deep darkness. Accurate descriptors of this world and the human experience absent of your Holy Spirit. And such were all of us when we were captives of sin and prisoners of darkness. But now we are your children, born of your will, your sacrifice, and your provision. Because you are the God who delights in showing mercy, we are not consumed by the broken systems and spiritual forces of evil in this world. By your grace, you alone, Lord, lifted us up out of our dark pits. You keep us standing by your grace, and you will carry us to completion into the very image of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. We've gathered here today to say thank you for your grace, truth, mercy, and freedom, and to be your hands and feet, serving, building up, sharpening, and comforting one another as your church, your body. Right in the face of every mountain we see and every burden that has been placed upon us, we remember, we believe, and therefore we declare that we are all accepted in the Beloved. And as Christ is, so are we in this world. We believe your word and we doubt our doubts. Amen.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you guys. Just a quick note on PD's announcement about the missions fundraiser. He just reminded me to tell everyone that there's not much time. The fundraiser is only 2 weeks away, so we need people to volunteer like right away, okay? I mean, you don't have to do it right now during the sermon, but today, and just volunteer for whatever you can, and that'll be very helpful for us all. All right. Why don't we take a moment and just greet your neighbor to your left and your right? Just say hi to each other. All right. Okay. Middle school can be a brutal time of life, right? I'm sure we have many memories. For me, from elementary school, first to sixth grade, I attended a private Christian school, right? And there, you know, life was pretty straight, plain, okay? But in seventh grade, I moved to a public school, and this is in the United States, and I was thrown into an oblivion, right? The first day of school, the first thing I noticed is that it seemed like everybody knew somebody, right? So I'm thinking, am I the only new kid, right? The second thing I noticed is that everyone cared so much about fashion, right? So private school, you have a dress code, but here there's no dress code. So like, you know, Guess jeans, Michael Jordan shoes, which are back now, Michael Jackson red leather jacket. You guys remember with all the zippers, right? Like I was all in at that time. Yes, I'm that old. Thank you. third, coming from a Christian setting, right? Christian school, elementary, public school felt like Sodom and Gomorrah. I mean, my goodness, you know, like, everyone's just cussing up a storm constantly, right? Girls and guys making out in the hallway, like, between classes. I'm like, what the heck's going on, right? And then there's, like, threats of fights all around, constantly, you know? So middle school is all about survival, right? If not physical survival, then definitely social survival, right? You have to make sure that you're not perceived to be a loser, right, by wearing the wrong clothes, or by not keeping up with the dirty lingo, you know, you have to say the right things. If you're not at the top of the animal chain, then you just want to make sure you're not at the bottom, right? So I'm not entirely sure why it happens around this time of life. You know, it's probably hormonal, but somehow we just become much more aware of ourselves in middle school, right? In terms of our being self-conscious, right? And in our self-awareness, we actively engage our pursuit of self-realization. Okay, now as I say this, I'm not necessarily referring to, like, you know, the hierarchy of needs, self-realization, that whole psychological structure there, although it's, you know, very much in line with that. But just in general, self, you know, we do that. We self-realize, right? Obviously, we have some level of self-awareness as children, but middle school seems to be where it really just takes off, right? Just very aware of ourselves. At least, you know, that's how it was culturally back in the 80s. You know, today, things are a little bit more fast with social media. It starts earlier for a lot of young people. Now, why is self-realization so important to us? Why do we care so much about how others perceive us? What they say about us? Why is it that we are, or what is it that we are aiming to become, right? And why? Why are we aiming to become that thing or those things? These questions have been asked and answered in different ways throughout this preaching series. This is the number six of seven. But to state it plainly, you know, we're all longing for significance, right? We're all longing to be important. We want to be considered as a person of value and a person of worth, right? That's what we're seeking. And so the truth is, self-importance is important. It's actually important. We are important. God created us, and he created us in his image. And this makes each and every one of us important. Because every human being reflects a little bit of God in some unique way. And whether we know it or not, all of us were trying to figure out what that little bit is, right? What it entails, what it looks like, and how to become that, right? It all starts when we're young, and I don't think it ever ends. Now, as important as our self-importance is, and as significant as we all are, we are not the center. Okay? We're not the center. And this is partly what messes us up. We get so caught up trying to establish our significance in life that we become the center of our lives. Right? Now, naturally, we might think, what's wrong with that? I am myself, right? And, you know, like, got to think about myself, right? So to this, I would say that, you know, obviously there is a natural instinct to protect the self and to create an environment for the self to flourish. Obviously, this is not bad. The problem is, generally speaking, it doesn't stop there, right? It doesn't stop there for us. In our pursuit of self-realization and self-importance, we inadvertently and often unknowingly, we make ourselves the center of the world, right? Where everything revolves around me, right? We seek to bring glory to ourselves. Thus, we long for the accolades, for the praises, for the approval of others to validate that we are important, right? And to make ourselves feel significant. In the second sermon of this series, we said that the glory of God in us is the image of God in us. Okay? We talked about that, right? Being made in God's image means that we carry a bit, just a bit, of his glory in us. And this is the bit that we are all trying to discover and to bring into realization into our lives. But notice that it's God's glory, not ours, right? The glory of God is the image of God in us. It's his glory, not ours, right? We just have a slice of it. And this distinction is very important. Human beings, we don't handle glory very well. We just don't. When we receive glory and when we receive honor from other people, our egos get stroked, right? Oh, yes, right? And we feel good about ourselves. We feel powerful. We feel beautiful, right? And we feel like gods and goddesses when we get glory. But this kind of glory is dangerous and arguably not appropriate for us because it infringes on worship. And if we're kind of honest, we like that. I like to be worshipped. It's not right, though. This is the problem with the ever-increasing celebrity culture in our world, right? There is an allure to the stage. There's an allure to the screen where captivating an audience, whether it's live or online, right, it tempts us into inappropriate God status. Similar to the serpent's half-truth, God knows that when you eat of the fruit, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, right? Knowing good and evil. Movie industry actors, big-time musicians, they have a difficult time handling their celebrity status. How much more your average teenager, right, on social media? Like, how do you handle all that, you know? And this is not merely a secular problem. How many Christian celebrity ministers have we seen take a big fall from their highly influential platform with sexual misconduct, power abuses, and money scandals? Whenever we are put on a pedestal with a bright, shining light, I mean, this is really bright right now, okay? It's okay, you don't have to fix the lighting. It's, but, you know, how many, right, whenever we're put on a pedestal with a bright shining light on us, no matter who we are, there's always a blind spot in our shadow, right? A part of us to which we fail to give attention, right? It's just too bright. I mean, figuratively speaking, right? It's just too bright, and it feels too good to step out of the light. And I'd rather stay here. I don't want to come back down from glory to reality. Who wants that? Thus, it's better, I would say, if significance and glory are conferred and not acquired. Okay? God already gave us his glory, right? He already gave us his glory, the image of God in us. Creating us in his image. He has infused us with, he has affirmed, he has confirmed our significance by giving up his son to have us back. What more do we need, right? There is no greater declaration of importance and significance than that. And this is all grace. This is grace to us. It is given to us apart from anything that we do, apart from anything that we can do, apart from anything that we have done. It is significance conferred upon us. On the other hand, when we try to acquire significance through our skills, our gifting, our abilities, our natural talents, our efforts, etc., that's simply our works that Paul addresses in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. You know, you've been saved by grace, not by works, so that no one can boast. But we want to boast, right? Trying to acquire significance through works that measure and compare is simply our attempt to validate ourselves, right? And so here we are back again in the realm of law that we've been talking about these past weeks, the realm of law. As we've been talking about this movement from the realm of law and standards to the realm of grace, we saw that the mood between the two realms switches from expectation, right? You're expected, to invitation, right? Under grace. Instead of feeling the pressure of demand that comes along with the fear of failure, we are delivered by the power of the cross into the realm of grace, where we have been set free from burden and free to be and free to become and free to explore in grace. Similarly, last week we saw how the mode of operation between the two realms transitions from rules, right, to relationship, right? When living under law and standards, how do you know how to move about in life? How do you know how to move up in life? In whichever particular category that you are striving, right? Rules. Rules are the guide for this realm. Do this and you will succeed. Don't do this or you'll fail. Right? That's the rules. But under grace, it is through relationship with the Holy Spirit that we are personally led through life in accordance with the Word of God coupled with prayer and relationship, right? And so now, today we're talking about self-realization. So with regard to the pursuit of self-realization, how do you become who you want to be? How do you become who you're meant to be? Right? And how do you even know what to aim for in the realm of grace? Because it's like, whoa, everything's so new, right? So this is it's an all-important question as identity and individuality are fundamental to the human experience, right, to our lives. So no matter how much we may want to emphasize the centrality of God, which is obviously something we do and we want to do that. We always want to emphasize the centrality of God. But no matter how much we do that, right? As opposed to, you know, the worldly mentality of me first, right? We cannot, nor should we ignore the pursuit of self-realization. Okay? God doesn't ignore it. Really, he doesn't. The whole life of David in the Bible, it addresses this, right? From shepherd boy to slingshot warrior, right? To military leader, to king of the nation, right? It's a process of his self-realization all the way through and through. In the realm of standards, the way that you know what and how to become whatever you want to become is by looking at the standard. You look up, what is the standard up there? Look at it, right? And mimic the standard. Just try to be like that. Just do what they do, right? Thus, the pursuit of self-realization in this realm is characterized by the word conformity, right? Conformity, just conform, okay? For example, here in Korea, as in most of the Western world, success is equivalent to a life of money and means, right? That's the formula for success. And the path, there's a laid out path to get there, right? We all, if you've been here long enough, you know the path, right? The path generally requires entrance into one of the sky colleges, right? Seoul University, Korea University, or Yonsei, right? Or any university in Seoul will do pretty much, right? But if you're going to get there, it means you need to have the good enough grades, right? Good enough score on the college entrance exam so that you can be part of that 2% matriculation to get into one of those colleges, right? Which means when you're younger, you have to go to Hagwon, right? The after-school academies. And then, you know, it all starts at the early age of 2, right? Where you have to start learning English, right? And start writing essays at age 3 and 4. You know, it's like, okay? So you laugh, but this is actually true. I know teachers who tell me this. It's crazy. So this whole path, this is called conformity, right? The same means to pursue the same goal. Nearly every young person I've met or encountered in Seoul is or has gone through this exact same route. Okay? There are exceptions, of course, right? So, for example, athletics, if you're an athlete or if you're musically gifted or if you're artistically talented, right? But these non-academic routes to success, they have a formula also that conforms to the standard of that particular arena. Okay? So it's the same. Aside from academics, conformity is clearly visible in the realm of physical appearance. I know I talk about this a lot, but I think it's just so relevant where we are here in Seoul, right? When certain fashions are in, right? When they're in, why do we go out and buy it? Because it's in, right? For many of us, it's important to keep up with whatever is currently in style. Not so clearly me, right? Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. No, right? So, and that's not a judgment statement. Please don't take that in any way at all, okay? But it's, you know, it's important for us to keep up with whatever is currently in style as it confirms to the rest of the world around us that we are not backwards, we are not country bumpkins, right? I think the Korean word is chonnam, right? We're not that. Maybe is that too bad to say on the pulpit? I don't know. Is that a bad word in Korean? Okay, sorry. Rather, right, we want to present ourselves as sophisticated, right? I mean, we're city people, right? We want to be cool. We want to be with the times. We want to be hip, right? Or whatever's the current lingo of the day. Obviously, I don't know what that current lingo is. I'm not with it, right? And I'm probably embarrassing my wife right now. She's like shaking her head. but we do this with spirituality as well, right? We conform to what everyone else does to validate ourselves, right, in the church. So, for example, and I wrote this for the Korean church. You know, actually, let me just quickly say that all these sermons, it's part of a book that I'm writing, so it's all going to come out hopefully later. But I wrote this part for the Korean church, right? If you belong to a church where everyone prays out loud at a high volume, right, but you usually do not feel led by God or by your inner conviction to pray in that way, do you conform to the prevailing culture of that church? Right? I've talked to people who felt like they had to. There's no choice about it, right? What if you can have a deeper connection with God in silent prayer, but that's never taught to you? You must express your prayers passionately and with fervent fire in order for God to recognize your sincerity. That's how it feels a lot of times, right? Now, please know that I am not speaking out against loud prayer at all. Passionate prayer, love it. I know many people who pray like this, and they're absolutely sincere, right? I pray like this sometimes, you know? The problem is when people feel pressured to conform as if this type of prayer is the standard. That's the problem, right? So that I can prove my level of faith to everyone else that I'm just as good a Christian as you are. That's the problem, right? So there's a common word in our English vocabulary that is often used to encapsulate the essence of this type of conformity. That word is should. You should pray like this. You should get this procedure done to look better. You should study more. You should buy this type of car. You should buy a pair of these pants. For many, the underlying message behind all these is you should dot, 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 because you're not good enough. Right? That's the underlying message a lot of times when we hear that. If you do such and such, then you're on your way to reaching the standard. Right? This is the world of conformity. Not only do we use should for future possibilities, but we also use it for past realities. Okay? So what do I mean by that? You should have studied harder to get into college. You should have prayed more for that meeting with the loan officer or whoever. You should have worked out harder in the winter and the spring now that summer's here. Right? You should have saved more money to buy that house. You should have practiced more for the recital. Right? Do you feel the accusation? You feel it, right? The underlying message is you should have dot, dot, dot to reach the standard. But since you didn't, you're a failure. And this is the world of conformity, right? Just to throw this in, I heard this from a sermon. The guy said, he was talking about this word. He said, don't should on me. Love it. Don't should on me. Okay, so the sad end result of all this is that everyone is the same. In the world of conformity, everyone's the same. Conformity leaves you with very few options and very little hope. Right? There's only one way to reach the standard. There's only one way, really, right? Or maybe a few, maybe, right? But if you miss it, then you're screwed. By virtue of its meaning, conformity is to take on the form of whatever image or standard that you are pursuing. That's conformity. And if there is only one standard in that arena, then there is no room to be different. Right? Everyone is trapped in a small world with no breathing room. This is the condition of soul, by and large. So, we've established that self-realization is important. We all want to become something and move towards a goal of achieving success that builds our sense of self and our sense of identity. Conformity largely seems to be the way that most of us pursue this. Okay. Well, as is the case with the mood of the realms being different, right? And the mode of operations within the realms of law and standards versus grace are different, there is a stark and significant difference between the realm of law and standards and the realm of grace with regard to the pursuit of self-realization. Okay? So in the realm of grace, instead of conformity to the standards of society and religion in order to validate yourself, since there is no longer any need for this kind of self-justification, the pursuit of self-realization is now characterized by something altogether different. And that is creativity. Creativity. Okay? Now, you might have already been thinking this as I was describing conformity, because there are many people who strive to be creative and different. Right? Many of us. And indeed, many of us are. However, I'm not talking about our creativity and our ability to be different. Human creativity is real. It has its place, no doubt about it. But rather, I am talking about God's creativity. God's creativity. So going back to Genesis 1, verse 1, we are told, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, meaning he created everything that is, right? In the very next verse, we see that the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters of the earth. Okay, a lot of times we kind of skip the second verse. Well, what was the Spirit of God doing hovering over the waters of the earth? Why is he there? What's he doing? Right? He's preparing the earth. He's preparing the earth for the creative explosion that was about to be released. That's what the Spirit of God was doing. The word for spirit in Hebrew, ruach, also means wind. Wind, right? And inherent in the word wind and ruach is the concept of energy and power. It's inherent in that word, energy and power, right? So the Holy Spirit had an active role in creation, okay? Harnessing all the potential waiting to be unleashed at the moment when the words of let there be would be spoken forth. Without the presence of the Spirit of God, the earth would not have been able to become what God had intended it to become. This is the context of the original creation in Genesis 1. But as you know, we've been talking about the new creation. Your mind's racing now? The new creation, this new world of grace, for which we have been set free and into which we have been invited, right? And the beauty of this truth about the original creation applied into the new creation is this. The same Holy Spirit who was there at the beginning of creation in Genesis 1 is the same Holy Spirit who came into the hearts of the disciples and all of us on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, right? That means that for all of us who are in Christ, which we've been talking about, what does it mean to be in Christ? For all of us who are in Christ, for those of us who believe and put our trust in him, we have received the promised Holy Spirit, who is the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. We have received that same Holy Spirit, right? And this same creative, energetic Spirit lives in us, doing a work of creation in us. Hallelujah. Right? Is that getting your juices flowing a little bit? Let's dive into this a little bit. So the word for created, used in Genesis 1, bara, means to bring into existence. That's the first meaning, right? But it also means to initiate something new. Okay? So the first meaning refers obviously more to the original creation in Genesis 1. It is commonly understood that God created, this terminology is ex nihilo, which means out of nothing. God created out of nothing, right? God brought everything into existence by the intention of his will through the utterance of his voice, right? God spoke and then everything came to be. All the earth and every living thing, including every person, did not and could not exist without God's creative work, right? So once there was nothing, and then there's something, right? Remarkable. Creation ex nihilo is unique to God alone. When we humans create, right, we use substances that already exist, things that are already there, right? We modify those things, we combine those things, but none of us creates ex nihilo, okay? Now, the other meaning of the Hebrew word bara, to create, is to initiate something new, okay? So this word is used, for example, in Exodus 34, when God graciously renews the covenant with his people after the rebellious incident of the golden calf, right? They had, you know, they just came out of Egypt, right? They're now free people. They, you know, Moses is receiving the law, but then they decide to make this golden calf and worship it, okay? And it's an act of rebellion. And so in verse 10, God says, right? He's going to renew the covenant with his people. He says, I'm making a covenant with you before all your people. I will do wonders never before done in any nation in all the world. That's what he said. I will do wonders never before done in any nation in all the world. So what is being said here is that in the presence of the Israelites, God will, and there's a commentator who uses these exact words. He says, God will create marvels never seen before. God will create marvels never seen before. He's using the word bara. He's going to create marvels never seen before. So God, back then, he did a new thing in Exodus 34. But the same holds true today, right? This is what God does. He is always creative. He is always at work. God is, right? Now, on the one hand, God is steady and he's unchanging, right? He's not fickle like we are, but he's always consistent with his character, and thus he is utterly reliable, right? But on the other hand, God is unpredictable. Even though he's consistent, he's unpredictable and full of surprises. You cannot put God in a box. You can't expect him to do the same thing the same way every time. This is not who he is. And this is true throughout scripture. He is a God who saves, and we see this constantly, but he always does it in different ways, right? Throughout the history of Israel and the history of the church, creating marvels never seen before. That's his trademark. Thus, it should come as no surprise that this is how God works in each and every one of us. Marvels never seen before, right? He created us individually with unique qualities and gifts and purposes, paths and peculiarities that should never be undermined, never. As Paul says in Ephesians 2, verse 10, for we are God's handiwork, also translated craftsmanship. Right? Isn't that awesome? We are God's handiwork. We are his craftsmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So what does that mean? It means God is an artist, and you are the artwork, right, of his hand. And generally speaking, the best artists, they never reproduce the same exact thing, right? Artists don't do that. They create new works of art. Sometimes they're similar, but much of the time they're vastly different, right? The possibilities of painting something new, the possibilities of sculpting an original, the possibilities of writing a unique song, they are literally endless, right? They're literally endless. How much more so every human being on the face of the earth, past, present, and future? Never mind that we are closing in on 8 billion of us, right? Not only do we all look different, though sometimes similar, but the unique combination of our skills and our giftings and our personalities, our nationalities, our contexts, our experiences truly makes each and every one of us one of a kind, right? We're one of a kind. So then, why do we try so hard to conform? Right? Why do we try so hard to conform to the standards of this world? Why do so many of us want to look like that supermodel? Why do we want to go to the same schools and work for the same companies? Why do we follow the rigid conformity of religious practices to prove our spirituality? For many of us, the reason is that these are the only ways we know how to become significant. It's the only way we know how. The rules of the realm of law and standards have been laid out for us. It's a formula, right? Follow the rules, the formula, and you'll rise to the top. And at the top, people are going to recognize you. And then you're going to feel good about yourself. And then the inner critic will finally be satisfied, saying, I am good enough, finally. Right? Until you realize once again, you're still not quite there. And you never will be, because it never ends, because the standard of perfection is beyond the grasp of fallen human beings. That's the truth. You'll never get there. Christ did it for you, so you don't need to. Right? That's the beauty. And since we have been delivered from the realm of law and standards and have been set free into the realm of grace, and once we truly realize this, then the felt need to conform, the felt need to conform to those standards and in order to prove our significance, right, no longer exists. The felt need no longer exists in the realm of grace. Instead, we are invited to the ways of the new creation, which is characterized by an inside-out orientation. It's characterized by an inside-out orientation. Galatians 4, verse 6, it says, since God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, right? Since God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the creative power of God to do a marvelous new thing, it works from the inside. Because he's in us. The Spirit of God is in us. So it works from the inside, right? The deepest desires of our hearts begin to change, wherein we want to love and honor God and seek first his kingdom. And as that happens, our minds undergo renewal as we spend more prayerful time in the Word. And what happens is our perspectives, our values, our attitudes all begin to change in the interior, in the interior. And this then produces a natural effect in our exterior actions and our lifestyles. It works from the inside out. That's the movement. That is the flow of this kind of growth. It's from the inside out. Right? On the contrary, the old ways of law and standards, it's the opposite. Right? It's the opposite. In this realm, the orientation is outside in. And this makes sense. It's important for us to know this distinction. There is an exterior law code, right? Or there's an exalted standard that stands outside of you and far above you. It's not in you, right? Definitely not in you. And as you try to conform to this law code or you try to conform to this standard, you are trying to get its values, you're trying to get its rhythms, its patterns, its rules, its formulas, you're trying to get it into you, right? But these are not natural to you. They're not natural to you because they stand outside of you. Just as much as tablets of stone, Ten Commandments, just as much as those cannot enter your body. That is why there is so much frustration in this realm. It is an unnatural flow, outside in. You cannot force yourself to become something that you are not, or something that you don't even want to be. Sometimes you don't even know it. But when the Spirit of God is in us, we begin to want to change. We want to become, we want to be the kind of people who don't murder, right? And by extension, the kind of people who don't hate. We want to become that. We want to become the kind of people who don't commit adultery. And by extension, people who lust. We want to become the kind of people who don't steal. And by extension, envy. Right? It works from the inside. We want to become like this. This is the law written on our hearts. It is inside of us. Right? So rather than conforming, we are transforming. We are transforming. Right? Conformity means that we take the shape of something that already exists, namely the standards of society. Right? So again, the easiest example is physical appearance. Right? We see the supermodels, we see the studs, and we sculpt our bodies and we starve to mold ourselves to these glittering images, right? And of course, it gets tiresome for our souls. It's the realm of law and standards. But the Apostle Paul, he addresses this in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It's a famous verse that many of us know. He says, do not conform. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Right? Now, Paul is not saying that you shouldn't work out. That's not what he's saying. He's not saying you shouldn't try to be fit, per se. He's not saying that. Rather, he's urging us to not buy into the values of this world by trying to live according to its standards and under that oppression of law and standards. Instead, in the realm of grace, in the new creation, we are invited to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And this word for transformation is the same root word that we get for metamorphosis. It is the same, right? Like a caterpillar to a butterfly, right? Metamorphosis. It is a new pattern of thinking, a new value system altogether. It is a new perspective and a new outlook on the world that is in line with Christ and the Spirit. And this is going to yield different results. Different results. So, for example, what would transformation entail for us in the arena of physical appearance? Right? Going with that same arena here. Well, first of all, there would be no singular, specified way to answer this. That's first, right? Persons transformed by the Spirit of God would all look fairly different, right? Because there is no singular body image, no specific body shape to aim for here. Each person would be free to develop as they wish, to work out if they want, to not work out if they don't want to. You're free, right? The main thing is freedom. There are no approving accolades here for this, for that kind of work. No approving accolades if you do it, right? And there's no condemning judgment if you don't, as opposed to this world, right? No pressure, no expectation, no demand. Now, perhaps you're hearing this and you might feel a little bit lost. Might be, sound a little bit disoriented, like, okay, what do I do? It's a little bit, right? Because all your life, you've been guided by a worldly standard with regard to your parents. Okay? I'm not going to give you a full answer to this, by the way, just so that you don't have, I don't have a full answer. But what you have to know is that there's nothing to guide you, right? Well, here in this realm, you have the Holy Spirit guiding you, and you're thinking, oh, now I only have the Holy Spirit to guide me, right? Now, as you think this, it's important to note, this doesn't mean that you can't follow the trends of society. Doesn't mean you can't. Doesn't mean you're not allowed to. Freedom means that you don't have to. That's what it means, okay? You still can if you want to, but you're free to. Whether you do or you don't, your significance, your value, your worth, your identity are no longer measured by your physical appearance. Your mind, that is the way that you think, is undergoing renewal, leading to total transformation of your being. So it doesn't really matter so much anymore. Now, I don't know about you, but this kind of gets me a little bit excited, right? Because the realms of possibility open up in so many ways and so many levels. Because, I mean, we're just talking about physical appearance. Everything is affected by grace. Everything. Right? We are no longer bound by these standards and expectations, not only of the worldly physical appearance, but also our career success, our church conduct, right? Our middle school humor, you know, right? Or you know, now we're now adults, right? Adult humor to try to impress other people. I don't have to try to fit that mold, you know, at the cocktail party. You know, I don't have to do that anymore, you know? I can be who God made me to be, and this is a process of discovery. Now, as an important caveat, let me say that our goal in self-realization is not simply an open-ended, formless blob, right? Like we talked about last week with that quote from Dallas Willard. We still need to become something. We need to become something, right? The law written on our hearts is still a law of some sort, some kind of there's a standard, right? And again, Paul provides us with the answer. In Romans 8, verse 29, he says, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Wait a minute. Wait. Did you just say conformed? Right? Aren't we supposed to be freed from conformity? Right? Yes, freed from conformity to the world. Right? However, conformity to the image of Christ is different. Very different. To become like Jesus is to become like God in the way that we were meant to be. In the way that we were meant to be, right? And God is so large and so all-encompassing that there is no way that we could conform to all that he is. There's not a chance, right? Being created in the image of God, we all have one unique little slice, right? Slice of the glory of God that is built into us. But in order for this conforming to the image of his son to take place, we need to undergo transformation. We need to go through that metamorphosis. And this is an inside-out process led by the same Spirit of God who hovered over the waters of creation and who works in yeast. He works in the dough, right? He works like yeast in the dough of this new creation, right? And he's doing this work, amazing work in us. And part of the beauty of this creative work of the Spirit of God to shape us and to grow us versus the conforming work of our efforts to be somebody, part of the beauty of all of this is that we can now relax. We can now relax. Right? It's all here. It's just so much pressure. It's so much stress to be something that you're not, right? Just trying to live up to, trying to measure up. Once again, there is no longer anything to measure up to because Christ did it for you, right? And so what we have is we want to pursue trying to measure up to Christ. But friends, this is not a burdensome type of measuring up. Right? Rather, it is an invitation. It is an invitation that he extends to us. An invitation to become truly human. An invitation not to become less of who you are, but to actually become more of who you are. We become less in terms of our flesh and our attempts to prove ourselves, less of our pride, right? Less of our fears and our insecurities, less of our self-glory. All these things are not who we really are. Instead, we become more. We become more in terms of our spiritual DNA, more of our God-given personality, more of the fruit of the Spirit, more of the image of God, more like Christ as we walk in this invitation. And though we can now relax, right? In this work of the Spirit, we don't simply remain idle, okay? Rather, we cooperate with the Spirit and we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And Paul again talks about in Philippians chapter 2, meaning we work out our salvation with an appropriate sense of awe and loving obedience that is not forced again. Are you lovingly obeying me? You know, no, it's not like that, right? But that invitation into loving obedience, right? To the one who gave up his life for us, right? I want to give my life for that. I want to do this, right? That's the realm of grace. So in closing, I think it's worthwhile to open the door of your imagination, just a tiny crack, and take this one step further. As you leave behind conformity to the laws and standards of this world as it pertains to your identity and your worth, right? That's what we've been talking about this whole time, this identity and worth. As you leave that realm and as you begin to undergo the inside-out transformation where the Spirit of God creates in you marvels never seen before, not only will your personhood be changed, right, self-realization, but also your creative pursuits will change. Okay? As the creator spirit works in you, you become creative as well, right? Wherein you are no longer bound to innovate in only the ways that everyone else does, right? And the implications of this, I think, can be rather expansive if you consider that the Spirit of God moves in you to create and to be innovative in the particular realms of gifting and interest that you possess, right? It's expansive, right? So I would urge you to lean in and partner with the Spirit of God in tackling the many problems of this world, right? In all the different arenas, the arenas of politics, the arenas of economy, the arenas of job growth, the arenas of education, of the arts, of media, of business and commerce, legislation, religion, world missions, crime and poverty, the list goes on and on. Imagine if every child of God intentionally worked in tandem with the Spirit of God to look beyond the norms and the standards of the world and to peer into worlds yet to be revealed. I mean, he's the creator. It's endless, the possibilities of what we can pursue in him, right? Don't be limited by the standards of this world. This is the realm of grace, the new creation. Amen? Let's pray together. So let's just take a moment and come to the Lord and present to him the different ways that you have been trying to conform to this world in order to prove yourself. In order to get your sense of significance. Whatever the realm is. As you begin to identify that, just cross over to the other side, to the realm of grace. Leave that world of conformity behind. And say, okay, Spirit of God, I'm here. Where are we going? What are you doing, Lord? Take me, shape me, mold me. So Lord, we come to you and God, we confess that this world is so new. The world of grace is so new to us. This new creation is so new. We cannot do it on our own. We know we're just going to go back to the law and the standards of this world. But we want to operate under the leading of your Spirit. Lord, we want to be conformed to the image of Christ. And we want to know what that looks like in our current context, in our particular situations, here in Seoul. Show us, Lord, lead us, God. Lead us in the creativity of your Spirit. That same Creator Spirit in Genesis 1 is in us, Lord. May we open ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take this time to respond to the Lord in worship and in song and in time of offering as well.
Can we all rise to our feet?
Who am I that the highest King could welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son.
I
Father's house, in my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes,
thank you, Lord, that you have set us free indeed. And Lord, the reality of the Father's house, it's not just for the future. It's already begun, Lord. The place of grace, God. Teach us to live here, Lord, to stay here. And to walk in this new creativity, God. Lord, we pray for a releasing of our minds of old patterns, old ways, old thoughts, old ways of conformity of how we should be and what we should do, into the transformation of the renewing of our minds in conformity to the Spirit of Christ, in how we are to be, but not just in terms of our being and our self-realization, but Lord, what you call us to do. Lord, it's so fun moving with you, going to places yet to be explored, coming up with new things that change the world, that change people's lives, even if it's just one life, even if it's just in the home, Lord, wherever, God, because you're just bursting with creativity that you want to unleash through us, God. And so may we gain your vision for life, Lord. Your vision of how to rule and to reign, how to lead, how to govern, how to build. So, Lord, we thank you, God. Thank you that you are with us in this way. Thank you for the plans that you have for us. Thank you that that in you we are now able to do this, Lord. So thank you, Lord. We bless you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Yes. All right. Why don't you just turn to your neighbor and just say, you are a new creation. All right. Amen. Okay. Let's close together with the singing of the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Now let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, as you go forth from this place, may the Holy Spirit set you free to truly be who he made you to be. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
All right, have a wonderful Sunday, everybody. If you're a newcomer, please join us for the newcomers orientation up here. Sign up for our missions auction.
Feel a dance because of his
Have a wonderful day.